The way that the evening is going to run is that we're going to invite Richard Susskind to talk to you for about 30 minutes, I think. And then each member of the panel will speak for about 5 minutes, giving you their perspective on online courts. I'm hoping at the end of that they will be able to have a little bit of discussion, but we want to leave enough time for questions from the floor, because I know there are lots of people in the audience who are keenly interested in this subject. So without further ado, I want to introduce Richard Susskind. You've got biographies in front of you. Many of you will know Richard. The only thing that I would want to add, which doesn't appear in his biography, is that his particular qualification for speaking on this subject, aside from his natural interest in all matters online, he did chair the Civil Justice Council Advisory Group on Online Dispute Resolution. That group reported in 2015, if I remember rightly, with great support from the Master of the Rolls, Lord Dyson, at that time. Some of the ideas in that online dispute resolution report were picked up by the report done by Lord Justice Briggs recently on reform of the civil court structure. So the idea of online dispute resolution is getting pretty well embedded. So I think this is a very good time to have a bit of a conversation about it. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Richard.
Thank you, Hazel. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A particularly good evening to that little person there, possibly the youngest person I've ever had in one of my audiences. But in many ways, this evening is for that baby and the generation of the child we see there. The case for online courts, it's not really a legal case, nor indeed is it a technological case I want to make. I suppose it's a moral case. What I'm saying this evening is that there are a number of emerging technologies that seem to me and to many others to hold the potential to greatly increase access to justice. And I think we are obliged, those of us who are involved with taking the legal system forward, at least to explore and experiment and develop some of these technologies. And I want to back all of this up by looking at these subjects. First of all, say something about the mindset that might be useful to have in thinking about the future, really by way of warm-up exercise. Then I want to explain to you what I mean by the first generation of online courts. Introduced a couple of distinctions that might be helpful, so we're speaking in the same terminology, and then make the broad case for change. After that, I want to tell you the story of online courts as it's evolved so far in this country, identify what are the benefits, seems to me, of these courts, penultimately raise some of the objections that I have read and heard, and respond to them, and just end with a couple of practical observations. So as for the mindset, those of you who know me well will know that for 25 years, I've talked about this slide and the one that follows. This slide is one that is put up by Black & Decker, or trainers within Black & Decker when they recruit new executives. They took the new executives into a room and they put up a slide, much like this slide before you, and say to the new executives, this is what we sell, isn't it? And the new executives look rather surprised by this. They say, of course that's what we sell, we're Black & Decker. And the trainers, with some satisfaction, say that's not actually what we sell, because that's not really what our customers want. This is what our customers want. And it's your job as new executives to find ever more creative, imaginative, competitive ways of giving our customers what they want. And I think there's a wonderful lesson here for everyone involved in the legal system and with law reform. Because too often, I'm afraid, when lawyers think about the future, we tend to be of power drill mentality. We tend to think, what do we do today, and how can we make it a bit quicker, cheaper, or better? Not often enough do we take the step back and ask, what's the actual mischief, the problem, the difficulty we're trying to solve? And might we actually have ways of coping with these difficulties that are entirely different from today's setup? So that's one thought for the future. Another, in my travels, I see so many different applications of technology in law. Just 3 or 4 years ago, there were fewer than 100 legal tech startup companies in the world. There are now well over 1,000. The whole area of legal technology is burgeoning, and that's the backdrop also of this evening's discussion. And so just for three small examples that struck me, a 19-year-old produces an online advisory system that's helped people appeal from their parking ticket, and apparently done so successfully over 160,000 times. A little online service, intuitive, easy to use, sorting people's problems. Or you go to Uganda, where a wonderful crowd of students, now graduates, have developed barefoot law, helping people who otherwise would have no access to legal guidance or legal insight putting it at their fingertips through mobile phones. It's a superb initiative. And when I visited China last year, I heard of a system that's got 12 million users. It's a mixture of online service and telephone call center, supported by 45,000 lawyers, and costing $2 a month for people to have guaranteed legal advice. So everywhere I travel, I see the innovative use of technology, and I think we should be able to do better in this country. I think our legal systems in Britain should be able to lead the way. And I think our starting point for this discussion this evening should be Kafka. He writes about this in two of his publications, but best known in The Trial. He says this: before the law stands a gatekeeper. A man from the country comes to this gatekeeper and requests admittance into the law. But the gatekeeper says that he cannot grant him admittance right now. The man from the country had not expected such difficulties. After all, he thinks, the law should be accessible to everyone at all times. After all, he thinks, the law should be accessible to everyone at all times. That's our challenge. Now, what I have in mind with the first generation of online courts is not these subjects. I'm not this evening going to talk about artificial intelligence or telepresence or robotic judges or machine learning. I can talk about these at length, but that's not what I have in mind as the first generation of online courts. I'm talking about the medium term, over the next 3 to 5 years, how we can introduce sensible technology to make our courts more accessible. And if I had to pick out 5 characteristics of the system I see evolving, it runs like this. It's a state-provided online dispute resolution service. It's a service where the parties do not need to congregate physically to resolve their differences. I have in mind, as others do too, as you'll hear, this is a court service that's supported by a new, highly simplified set of rules and procedures. And again, what I and others have in mind, insofar as we can, we'll have common practice across civil, family, and tribunals. And every time today I say courts, I'm meaning tribunals as well, and Sir Ernest will be talking a lot more about tribunals too. And finally, this is a system I have in mind that's affordable, it's quick, it's intelligible to the non-lawyer, and it's proportionate. That's the broad vision of the online court. I want to emphasize from the outset, it's not suitable for all cases. I'm not here to say this will replace all cases that pass through our justice system, not at all. I want to refine on this point quite considerably later on. Let me introduce a couple of distinctions as promised. The one I often use in technology, and again, it's a little bit like the one of the hole in the wall and the power drill, the distinction between automation and innovation. Automation is what most people think of when they think of technology. You take some kind of task or process or activity and you streamline it, you optimize it, you computerize it, all these kinds of words. The fundamental point is it's usually an inefficient pre-existing process to which you apply technology. And that can often take us a long way. But the really exciting thing about technology is not to automate what already goes on, but actually is to use technology in what I call innovative ways, which means to use technology to allow us to do things that previously weren't possible. And I think that's the spirit of the online court. It's not cutting and pasting the existing court system and putting it online. It's seeing how we can use the power of technology to allow us to deliver court service in entirely new ways. Just as terminological matter, and these are my definitions, but I think they're generally followed, the difference between a physical courtroom where people physically congregate together, a virtual courtroom, which I usually have in mind, there is a physical court, but people's participation is often remote by video, for example. So there is a courtroom, but people aren't necessarily all together in that room. Some are participating by video. And then online, where there's no courtroom, where in a variety of ways the work of the court is done electronically. And this is a huge oversimplification, but you can imagine, whether it be a tribunal or a court case, there are various elements. There's the filing of the documents, the raising of the action, however one might want to phrase it. There's the administration of the case, there's the management of the case, and case administration systems and case management systems are quite different phenomena. There's the idea of actually making an argument and responding to arguments, and there's decision making. Now, in the online court concept, I believe all of this is done online. One can also see, and this will no doubt happen, that for some cases, the filing, the administration and management will be online, but the argument and decision making will be in a physical courtroom. We'll mix and match. Court as a service, and I'll get back to that in a second, and some of it can be online, and some of it can be, it seems to me, in the physical, traditional way. But when, from start to finish, the entire process is electronic without physical congregation, I think we're talking about an online court. So what's the case for change? Why should we bother? Is there something broken? Is there a burning platform? Here's some clear problems, it seems to me. And I want to say that my emphasis very largely this evening is in very low-value disputes. The kind of disputes that cause people great grief, the kind of disputes that often people can't pursue because the system seems disproportionate. But we have some clear problems with low-value disputes in the civil system. To pursue a case through our civil courts, generally, relative to the amount involved in a low-value dispute, is too costly, is too slow. For the non-lawyer, the process is unintelligible, and it's out of step in the internet society, a society in which, on an everyday basis, so very often, we're gaining information, receiving service, interacting with others across the web. Too costly, too slow, unintelligible, and out of step in the internet society. Now, I want to stress that, certainly insofar as low-value disputes are concerned, these are problems with or without legal aid. Some people say the answer, of course, is to bring back far greater legal aid, and therefore lawyers can sort out these difficulties. But actually, in terms of proportionality, if the cost or the value of an action is low, the system is too costly and often too slow and unintelligible and out of step, whether or not there's state funding of lawyers. So this takes us to online courts, and I want to tell you the story, and it's one with which I've been happy to be involved. In a sense, the core document in terms of my own thinking contribution was this one. In February 2015, the group I chaired, the Online Dispute Resolution Advisory Group of the Civil Justice Council, produced this paper on how we might use ODR, online dispute resolution, for low-value civil claims. Here was the problem we were asked to solve. Look at a system, and again, you'll see some of the overlap: too costly, too slow, too forbidding, unintelligible, often too combative, disproportionate in a variety of ways. We also were alerted to the problem of unmet legal need, this idea that there are innumerable problems that people out there suffer from, and they don't even get to the court system because in one way or another, they're scared off, they believe it's beyond their pocket, it's too forbidding and so forth. And again, out of step with the internet society. So our challenge was to see whether or not the field of online dispute resolution might offer some solutions to these problems. Lord Dyson, then the Master of the Rolls, to whom I was responsible in writing this report with the committee, has a far pithier way of putting the problem. He said any system that has a 2,000-page user guide is a problem. And that was his reference to the laws of civil procedure. So what we did in our project, and it took us about 9 months, we undertook to have a look at this field ODR and see whether or not it might map onto or be useful for the resolution of civil disputes. Our remit was to look at claims less than £25,000 to try and anticipate future developments. I put together a team of genuine specialists, a number of people with doctorates in related areas and in ODR specifically, with practitioners, with court officials and so forth. We published in 2015, this on a website, and on the website also we have interviews with the top half a dozen ODR specialists in the world. So we're just trying not only to make some recommendations but to raise awareness of the potential of this technology. What attracted us, though, from the get-go, and I accept anyone who's around the table was in principle sympathetic, but we were attracted by the potential of this technology. Imagine, we thought, if dispute resolution could be as easy as using Amazon. Imagine if dispute resolution and low-value claims is genuinely affordable. And we're struck by one contribution when someone pointed out to us, the homeless now have handhelds as well, this ubiquitous access to information and service. We had a submission on the inaccessibility of traditional courts for disabled people, many millions of whom either cannot attend court at all or can only do so with great difficulty. Imagine a system that's more natural for the internet generation, for the little person over there. Think about the possibility of taking so many ill-suited cases that clog up our court system out of the courts and saving money, or the idea of meeting this great body of unmet legal need and increasing access to justice. Or to put it in the language of the Dutch, who are doing some parallel work here, they said, imagine a system, an online system, that could be fast, fair, and efficient. And to that, we added a proportionate. ODR is not a new field. The first international conference on ODR, I think, was held in 1996, and as many books were already published in this area. We had a new twist on it because ODR was often regarded as a branch of ADR, a new alternative method of dispute resolution, our thought was quite different. We thought, what about using the techniques of ODR and actually changing the court system accordingly? Underpinning this was a wider conception of access to justice. Many people, when they speak about access to justice, and in some ways I think it dates back to Lord Wolfe's seminal reports in 95 and 96 called Access to Justice, many people who talk about better access to justice often mean improved access to dispute resolution. And we accept that, but we also say a good justice system should do more than simply resolve disputes. Surely, systemically, it should encourage disputes to be contained. One of the difficulties often when courts and lawyers get involved is that disputes can escalate beyond anyone's reasonable wishes. But even before then, surely there's the field of dispute avoidance. I've never yet met a non-lawyer who prefer a big dispute well resolved by lawyers and courts to not having a dispute at all. That's not how the non-lawyer thinks. And so we should want, as I often say, to put a fence at the top of the cliff rather than an ambulance at the bottom. And together, these three elements, we think, make up access to justice. We want a justice system that can allow us to resolve disputes, contain disputes, and avoid disputes. And what's interesting, however, today is that the emphasis of the state is actually in the lower rung, in the resolution of disputes. So far, the state has invested very little in dispute containment or dispute avoidance. The fundamental question we ask then and I ask now is, court a service or a place? Do you really need physically to congregate together to resolve all differences? Or might we deliver a court service in a new and a different way? The recommendation we made was quite simple. We said that in civil cases for under 25,000, there should be an online court established. And we also at the same time said these same techniques could equally be used in family and tribunals. The service we had in mind was a three-tier service. On the lower rung, as it were, the third tier, if I can put it that way, it's judges deciding cases on the papers alone, perhaps with some telephone conferencing and in due course some video conferencing, but not physically congregating. So be absolutely clear, this is fully qualified judges involved with the decision making. But our point was, before cases reach judges, wouldn't it be great if there was a kind of online, and again perhaps telephone or video supported, process of facilitation in the spirit of ADR, so that, and they're now, I believe, being called case officers, can look at a case, help the parties, cajole them, whether it be through a form of mediation or early neutral evaluation, or simply some warm welcome advice and guidance and some empathy, perhaps resolve or contain these problems and difficulties so they don't need to reach the judge. And even before then, we thought, wouldn't it be great if people could just go online and get some sense of the nature of the legal problem they have, the options open to them, and perhaps even what their entitlements might be. And our view was that a court system of the future is not simply dispute resolution by judges, whether or not online, but we try to extend this concept, and we believe that a great justice system is one that helps people contain their disputes and helps people avoid their disputes through this three-tier system. So that was the basic recommendation. Put a little more systematically, at the bottom, you have dispute resolution in the third tier, judges working online, and we had in mind a largely adversarial process. Since then, largely due to the work that Sir Ernest and others in the tribunals are doing, I think I've changed my mind on that. I don't think it should be purely adversarial. I think you can have a different method and process, almost a merger of the second and third tier, and Sir Ernest is going to say more about that. But in our model, and it still works, adversarial system, judges deciding cases online. Before these cases reach the judges at the second tier, the case officers, the facilitators, more of an inquisitorial investigatory process, working towards, where possible and appropriate, containing the disputes, and before even reaching the second tier, the first tier, the online tier again, this idea of dispute avoidance. It's more of an informational service, a form of online evaluation of the problems that people have. So that was the basic idea. Lord Dyson, who was very supportive throughout, said publication of this report is an exciting milestone in the history of our civil justice system. As you can imagine, our committee loved that quotation, and we use it regularly. But I think it was interesting that it seemed to capture the imagination of people who are perhaps not otherwise necessarily enthusiasts for technology. What benefits did we have in mind with all of this? Very simple. Our view was that fewer cases will reach judges. Those that do will cost less. It's a huge impact, again, Susan may talk about this, on the cost of the estate, if you have fewer courtrooms. But the top two tiers, this idea of having systematic online ways of helping people contain and avoid their disputes, online information and guidance, and the work of case officers, that increases access to justice. But we did say absolutely clearly, not suitable for all cases. What are the benefits for litigants? Above all else, perhaps, this idea we could be offering a route to the resolution of disputes where today many people have no route, none at all. And whenever I hear people criticizing online courts, even, and they are imperfect, I think again and again, surely it's better we offer this kind of system than what people have today. That's the better than nothing argument. But more importantly, perhaps for others, this could perhaps provide a more convenient, less costly, speedier, more understandable route for those who do currently litigate. It's a transformation of the court system. It's a challenging one, is the notion of judges without courtrooms, of even justice without lawyers. We had some support, and I want to make clear on one point, we talked about eBay a lot. It is a fact that eBay resolves through its ODR platform 60 million disputes amongst traders every year. That's a fact. We were not suggesting we should use eBay's ODR system. We were simply pointing out that there is some precedent for human beings who are in conflict over relatively low value issues to come online and sort them out without the use of a competent adversarial system. We also looked to the Financial Ombudsman Service, terribly influential, resolving disputes often between individual citizens and, for example, financial services companies. In 2014, managed through about 500,000 disputes. 90% of these were sorted out in what we would call tier two by their adjudicators. So only 10% reached the actual ombudsman, and only 20 cases in that year were resolved on a face-to-face basis. Now, many of these disputes are very simple, similar in nature and scope to those that we were talking about, the low-value civil claims. And frankly, around the world, there are innumerable other examples which show this isn't fanciful, this isn't invented, there's empirical evidence to suggest that people can resolve their disputes differently. And I recommend to you, because this is a growing, it's a burgeoning field, about to come out over the next few months are two fantastic books on this subject by the leading experts in the world. Ethan and Orna, who wrote the book Digital Justice, both of which I've had the good fortune to read in proof. Digital Justice is a superb theoretical and practical introduction peppered with all sorts of illustrations around the world of online dispute resolution. And Colin and Amy's book focuses only on consumer disputes. And that's more of a handbook of practical illustrations. It's hard to read these two books and feel that we're not in the middle of great change. So how do people respond to the report? Media, very, very, very encouraging indeed. I think it's in many ways the argument was a good one. The argument was that we can offer greater access to justice at a lower cost to the state. It seems almost unassailable. The Lord Chief Justice was very supportive. On 22nd of June 2015, very clearly endorsed the recommendations of the report. The day after, the then Lord Chancellor, Michael Gove, similarly endorsed the idea. Amazingly, and again, Susan can say more of this because she comes from the Treasury, but historically the Treasury has not been supportive of major reforms to the court system. There was an announcement in the spending review and autumn statement 2015, more than £730 million being invested in the modernization and digitization of the court system. That's clearly not all online courts, but that's a scale that we'd never seen before. Then Lord Justice Briggs, in his interim and his final report, took forward the idea of the online court and the three tiers and supported it very strongly indeed. In fact, gathered a whole bundle of other recommendations around it, and I felt very deftly argued against those who had opposition to the idea. So we've been getting a lot of support. More recently, a lot of this was brought together in the paper by the government together with the senior president and the Lord Chief, called Transforming Our Justice System. And even last week, there was another paper that came out that responded in one particular issue for tonight, perhaps, about the whole issue of assisted digital, more of which in a second. How do the legal professions respond? I've changed colour to indicate the mood of the moment. It's understandable. I've written a book with my son on the future of the professions. We've looked at the future of doctors, of teachers, of auditors, of architects, of tax advisors, of journalists, management consultants, even of the clergy. And anyone, when they're faced with the prospect of working fundamentally differently because of technology, will tend to raise objections. So it's absolutely fine and it's healthy. But it does lead me neatly into the objections. And I find there's six of them that come through, and they're all, I don't want to dismiss any out of hand, they're all important, but I think there are significant responses to each. So let me track through each one very quickly. One observation that's often made is, we get it, but surely what you're delivering, therefore, is an economy class justice. Litigants in person, people of limited means, will have to have this substandard online service, whereas people who are better off in big organizations will have the proper physical courtroom. Surely you don't want two tiers of justice. I see the point, but my genuine belief is that a service that's more affordable, it's more intelligible, it's less forbidding, it's quicker. I don't regard that as an economy class system at all. If anything, that's going to be the first class system. So I see the point, but it seems to me for many people, the online service will be superior. There's the argument from open justice, and this is the idea, if it's all done electronically, how on earth do we have a transparent system? Our system is characterized by its transparency, that there's public access to dispute resolution. We can view the justice system ourselves. Anyone can turn up at a courtroom. And it seems to me that's an absolutely vital objection. My own view is that an internet-based court service is likely to be more transparent and visible, and so more public, and to larger numbers of people. And I think, again, when you hear Sir Ernest describe what they have in mind for the resolution of tribunal decisions online, and that entire process can be viewed, I don't mean by looking into a courtroom, but the dialogue between the tribunal judge and the parties can actually be viewed. This is a level of transparency that we've never seen before, in the sense that every user of the internet can have a look at this. Not only that, the plan will surely be that we can look at the statistics, the workflow through the system in a way we've never seen before. And so I see the point. And I believe it's very important that justice is not just done and seen to be done. Remember, I'm not really talking about criminal here. I'm talking about civil, family, and tribunals. But I think, and all the evidence for other systems suggests, that a web-based system can be more rather than less transparent. What about the point about face-to-face justice? Many people have this feeling that it's of the essence of dispute resolution by the courts, that the judge can look the parties in the eye, that they can look one another in the eye, that it's human beings interacting in the same physical space. This is essential to the process of justice. I understand that point as well, but I think it's quite interesting to ask and answer the question, what kind of claim is that when we're asserting the importance of this? I used to teach jurisprudence, and so I was reflecting on legal philosophy and legal theory, and I find no justification for that claim there. If you look at natural justice, this is the idea that no one should be a judge in their own cause, that a judge should be independent. You get the opportunity to plead your case. That's not threatened by the model of online courts that I and others have in mind. If you look at notions of substantive justice, of formal justice, of distributive justice, all the work that's been done in thinking about a just system, nowhere do I find the assertion jurisprudentially that you need physically to be eyeballing one another. It's a face-to-face business. Nor do I find any constitutional justification, either in theory or practice. I know of no constitutional principles which suggest that justice means the face-to-face resolution of disputes. I think the claim is a psychological and emotional one. I'm not criticizing it, because in a way I feel my intuition at the beginning was to think the same. But I think we have to be clear what kind of claim we're making. We have a sense that justice is best dispensed in one location where everyone's taking responsibility for their own respective parts in the process, together in synchrony. But it is a psychological or emotional phenomenon. And in fact, therefore, it's an empirical claim. And we've got to test that claim, not least with the internet generation. Is it the case that that little person in 15 years' time will think that it's a more just system that allows people or requires people physically to congregate, or will it be more natural, in fact, to have disputes resolved online? I'm not necessarily answering that question, but that's the question to answer. I don't think we can simply stipulate that justice requires face-to-face presence. Or let me put it in the words of Abraham Maslow, the great organizational psychologist. He says, I suppose it is tempting if the only tool you have is a hammer to treat everything as if it were a nail. And our problem as lawyers, and I've been thinking about law and legal theory and judicial decision-making myself for 35 years, is you tend to look at the world through legal spectacles. And I'm saying maybe we should take these off. If you look at through legal spectacles, they say, of course, disputes have to be resolved in a courtroom. Court is a place rather than a, or as well as a service. What about digital exclusion? The argument there being, hang on a second, lots of people haven't got access to the internet, particularly litigants in person who are hard to reach in any event. There's quite a lot of speculation about the number of people, speculation amongst lawyers about the number of people who use the internet. But it's pretty clear from all the research that 85 to 90% of people in this country use the internet in one way or another. Now, if you add into that the Oxford Internet Institute, where I'm involved, we talk about proxy users. This is the notion that even if you're not a user of the internet yourself, do you have someone who can use the internet on your behalf? So if your grandfather can't use it, maybe your granddaughter can use it for him. That actually means that those who are effectively excluded from using the internet is less than 4%. Now, there's no room for guesswork here. I go to meetings amongst people who are working in the charitable sector, and they say things like, I would say 50% of my people don't use the internet. That is not serious empirical research. Again, we need serious research here. But remember, it's not just current litigants, it's the latent litigants as well. It's the people who would be using the system if it were more accessible, who feel excluded in other ways. I'm not for a second saying that we should not pay any attention to the digitally deprived. And indeed, in the response last week by the government to its consultation paper, they have a whole set of strategies for what they call assisted digital. And that's fundamental. That's the answer. For people who are digitally excluded, you provide the assisted digital service. But to think that we should be holding back because of the 4%, it seems to me is allowing the tail to wag the dog. Loss of majesty. It's a term used by both judges and generally barristers rather than solicitors who are saying that if we have, that was not meant to be an amusing comment, that's a matter of empirical fact. It may also be amusing, but it's just an observation. But this notion of majesty, that, and again, I have emotionally strong sympathy with this, the court system, one of our great long-standing institutions, are we diminishing it by making court service available online? I'm not sure about the term majesty. What matters to me, and again, thinking back to my days of teaching legal theory, we didn't speak about the majesty of the court system, we talked about the authority of the court system. We talked about its effectiveness, we talked about its respect for it, we talked about its relevance. And so it seems to me that it may be less majestic, but a system that has complete authority, for which people have deep respect, and is regarded as relevant in the 21st century, is a system that actually has great foundations. Think about this. We may have to choose between the majestic, rarely used physical court system as against the effective, popular, private sector ODR. Because be in no doubt, ladies and gentlemen, if the court system doesn't introduce the online court over the next couple of years, there will be private sector alternatives in place. Some of you may say you would like to leave it to the market. I feel that actually fundamental to the rule of law is that we have an effective mechanism for the resolution of disputes, and that can be online. But just now, the choice without online courts is, as I put it to you on that slide, what I would prefer is an effective, popular, authoritative, respected online court that could underpin and help maintain the rule of law. A final objection is it's all too ambitious. And this is the one with which I've got the most sympathy, in fact. Although I'm an enthusiast for it, in practical terms, I think I want to move more slowly and more cautiously than many others now. There's two concerns here. One is this idea, all cases under 25,000. Our remit was to look at cases under 25,000, but our own view as a group was we should start off with very low value claims. Lord Justice Briggs in his reports has said we should perhaps have a soft launch. This is under 10,000. Again, our group would go even lower than that now. Because in the first instance, when one, more of which in a second, is piloting and experimenting, it seems to us that low value claims, consistent with everything that most people do in introducing new technologies, you start at a modest level and you build up. And remember also, I think we were simple-minded in our report thinking it was all about value. Because you can have a very low value dispute that raises very complex issues of law or that really does require face-to-face contact. On the other hand, you can have a very large dispute that actually is legally quite straightforward. So it's not just about value. The other thing is it's a public sector IT project, and we know what happens to them. And that, of course, is a valid concern. Above all else with that, you've just got to avoid the blueprint-driven Big Bang development, this idea that we are clever enough that we can design the whole thing in advance, we can put in place a set of rules, we can launch it as one monolithic system. That won't work. So practicalities and conclusion. My view is to make this happen, we've got to start modestly and we've got to pilot and experiment and grow. Secondly, and I think our chair will be pleased with this if she's not pleased with my overrunning, we've got to study the results. We've got to undertake research at every stage to see how effective the processes are and get feedback from the users. We've got to build incrementally in a modular way and refine as we go along. Not one big bang, we have to show restraint. The temptation of the budget and the political will and the judicial support is to go hell for leather. We have to exercise restraint. Reminder, our system just now for low value disputes is too costly, it's too slow, it's unintelligible. Many people effectively have no access at all today, and yet we're living in an increasingly digital world. Voltaire, if he'd been with us today, would have said we should not allow the best to be the enemy of the proportionate. I know that, of course, sitting with an outstanding judge and pleading a case before that judge, there's probably nothing like it in our justice system, and it won't really be replicated by an online court system. But that's something we can't afford. We've got Rolls-Royce for a very few, and everyone else is walking. We cannot allow the notion that we can't put in place a perfect system. We can't allow that to prevent us putting in place a better system. In the end, ladies and gentlemen, this is about increasing access to justice and promoting the rule of law. We're in a situation where we are in grave danger of our court and tribunal system being alienated from many people. If we make it accessible online, we can increase access and increase confidence in the rule of law. That, I think, is our future. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Richard. You've set out a very ambitious vision with a typically powerful justification for it. You picked up some of the things that I was going to attack myself towards the end. But what I want to do now, given that we've overrun a little bit, and I want to give time for the panel to give us their responses and also for the audience to ask some questions, I'll move straight away to the first person that I'm going to ask to speak, which is Susan Acland-Hood. She is the Chief Executive of Her Majesty's Courts and Tribunal Service. She's been in post since November 2016, and she is the senior responsible owner and accounting officer for the reform of courts and tribunals. That's the correct terminology. That's quite a big job, Susan. And Susan's going to tell us where things have got to in kind of bringing into being some of Richard's vision. So thanks very much, Susan.
Thank you very much indeed. That's not how I introduce myself at parties. First of all, I just want to say thank you very much for having me here. It's an enormous pleasure to be here. As Hazel said, I've not been doing my job enormously long. As Richard said, I used to be at the Treasury. I now feel the need to say categorically that I didn't actually vote myself £1 billion at the Treasury and then immediately move into my new job to spend it. I did something slightly different at the Treasury. But I think that I have one of the best jobs in government. And I think that because I'm responsible for a service that does something that is fantastically important. As Richard says, this is about underpinning the rule of law, something which feels particularly important in the world at the moment, to me at least. And we've got an opportunity to take through a really ambitious programme of reform that will transform the service that we offer people. And the three principles on which we are transforming the service are the principles of making the service more just, more proportionate, and more accessible. And I think it's important to say that I don't see those principles as defensive. I don't think we're at risk of doing something through reform that puts them at threat. I think it's about actively trying to make the system better at doing all three of those things through everything that we do. And we know that there are lots of things about the court system that need to be better. I've spent quite a lot of time since I was appointed travelling up and down the country, visiting as many courts as I can, talking to lawyers and judges and to my staff. And I've met a huge number of extremely dedicated, committed people who work in Her Majesty's Courts and Tribunals Service and who are serious about the work they do, who understand its importance and who want to serve people better. But they are hampered in the way they work by the processes we use, by our failure to modernise over many years, and by the tools we give them to do their jobs. And similarly, the way we do justice overall hasn't taken advantage of what technology can offer. And I agree with Richard's analysis. We waste other people's time and effort too much. That would be my single encapsulation of the biggest problem with our justice system. We treat other people's time as free the whole time. We overcomplicate. We take too long over simple things. And at the moment, we struggle to give the resource, time, and attention that we should give to more serious matters, and even to do quite straightforward things like maintain our court's estate properly. Much of what we need to do is neither complicated nor controversial. We need proper case management systems so we can stop wheeling baskets of photocopies through file-crowded corridors. We need modern systems that mean that people answer court telephones. We need an end-to-end system to join up the police, prosecutors and the courts to end the paper go round between them and stop us losing things. On these, the question is not whether it's a good idea. The question is only whether we can do it well. As Richard mentioned, we need to face the bugbear of this is a government IT project, surely you should give up now. By the way, I will talk a bit more later if people want about why I think that we can deliver these things and the way in which we're going to do it in bite-sized chunks with lots of testing. But here, we're talking about the online court. Now, this is something that goes beyond streamlining our administration to thinking differently about the delivery of justice itself. And I think this is something we should approach respectfully and with care. Our justice system leads the world. It really does. It might not in the future if we don't try and keep up. But, you know, so we should ask ourselves seriously the question, why change it? Why don't we just stop at tidying up our paper shuffling and getting our administration sorted out? And I think that depends on how serious we are about the principles of a system that is just, proportionate and accessible. And I don't want to repeat Richard's talk, but I think it comes back to the point about how many people there are out there who are getting ripped off by their builder, or on the other side, not paid by that client, and who conclude that going through the system is just too complicated, too expensive, too much of a headache, too much of a time sink. Think about how much you would have to be out of pocket to bother. It's probably quite a lot. And you are relatively legally aware, thoughtful people. Some of you may even have time. I don't, but, you know, some of you may. So what would you have to have lost to conclude it was worth it, that you could be bothered? I don't think that that makes our system just or accessible, and that comes of not having a way of getting justice done that is proportionate. So I don't think ignoring the opportunities presented by online routes to justice is the right thing to do. Although we need to approach them carefully, I think it is important that we do approach them. And as Richard has said, we've got strong political backing and we are underway with several pieces of work in this area. What we do think is that it's incredibly important to do this carefully with thought and wide consultation. And that comes out in the work we're doing in three main ways. First, everything we do involves starting small. So this principle of starting with something that is contained and manageable and then building it in small pieces, testing it with users, changing it if it's not right. That's the way we're approaching the system. I'm going to just very briefly show you if the technology works. It would be embarrassing if it didn't at this point, wouldn't it? A very tiny bit of our beginnings of a system for civil money claims online. So this is the direct response to the proposition that we should have a system for resolving small value money claims. Now, this is an alpha. This is not publicly released. Nobody else has seen this. You are immensely privileged. That's not quite true, actually. We have a set of engagement groups on which both the Law Society and the Bar Council sit, and we are trialling this at the moment with potential users. So we're taking people through these screens and asking them, does this make sense? Do you understand it? By the way, this is not a lawyerless court. I'd just like to make that very clear. You can see it there. This is a court that is open to anybody. And there are just a set of screens that take you through, including asking you to pay, who you're claiming against, tells you, asks you to say what you're claiming about, so I'm not going to show you all the screens, you're allowed, you can put in details of why you're owed the money. There are more detailed screens that allow you to give more information who you're claiming against, and then ask you to sign a statement of truth, tell you that you've submitted your claim, tell you what's going to happen next, and then allow interaction. And then give the opportunity to respond to that interaction in a range of different ways. And again, tell you the agreement that you've made. Give you terms. So I'm not suggesting, just to be completely clear, that we have all the answers or that we've got that system right. I suspect that even in flashing up those screens, there will be people out there thinking, well, I don't like that bit. I think that could be much better if you did it differently. Or I think you've got those pieces in the wrong order. And the second principle, so the first principle is we're starting small. The second principle is that we want to involve both experts and users in everything that we do. So as I say, both the Law Society and the Bar Council are founder members of our engagement groups, and each of the services we're developing have both expert users involved in this stage of development before they go out anywhere, but are also designed so that we beta test, again, starting very small with a limited number of people, and ask people what they think about the service. So I've got a couple of other things on here. This is help with fees. This is live. So this allows you to claim help with your fees at the moment. And we used to kick back more than half of help with fees claims because the form was filled in wrong because people didn't understand it. Having moved to the online system, we're able to, it just does that thing that all internet forms do, which, you know, if you put your address in a way that doesn't look like an address, it tells you. That means that we now kick almost none back for being filled in wrong. People can get help with their fees much, much more quickly. We also have in beta our apply for a divorce service. So this one is in the beta stage. We are using this with real applicants for a divorce. This has one of those things that kind of does come to the majesty question a little bit. You do have to do a tick box for adultery. Personally, just have a little kind of moment when that screen comes up. It is interesting. Users don't seem to be that bothered by that. 98% of divorces are uncontested, but we still make people go through an incredibly long and elaborate process in order to get a divorce. It takes people between 40 and 50 minutes to fill in the current divorce application form. Our users who've gone through this beta test service have averaged about 10 minutes and have found the service easy to use. I'm not talking about 10 minutes from filling in a form to getting divorced, just to be very, very clear. I'm just talking about how much of people's time we're asking them to spend filling in a form. That's what I'm talking about. The principle is that we sit, so in early beta, we actually sit with the user, we watch them fill in the form, we see which stages are easy and which are difficult. In later beta testing, we take feedback. So you can see at the top, it says, this is a new service, your feedback will help us to improve it. You can click on there and you can say, I don't like this bit, I didn't understand that bit. There are parts of the divorce service where we are working with you, with the developers to think about. So the very first, we're going to get to the point where you can upload your marriage certificate and send it in. We wanted to get something out to start testing screens before we got that functionality. And so at the moment, you have to copy out bits of your marriage certificate. And that screen has been really problematic for users because we put up an example of a marriage certificate and quite a lot of users copied out the example. There is definitely quite a lot of work for us to do in understanding how people behave when confronted with the service and improving that. But the good thing about the system is what we have not done is designed a system that invites people to copy out an example marriage certificate, rolled it out across the nation, realised it was a problem, and then had an enormous problem changing it. We've deliberately designed this to start small, to iterate and to build with users and experts. So if you're interested in this, this is my kind of call to arms. If you're interested in this, if you think this is, A, if you think this is interesting, but actually, B, if you think there's risk here and that we might be going to do it wrong, let us know. We're always interested in having more people who can help us use and test our services as we build them. And then the third principle is one that Richard spoke about also a bit, which is that this is about giving people better services. And it's about the right service for the right thing. And it is not suitable for all cases. So I do not anticipate that there will be tick box screens for your next murder trial. I don't think that's going to happen. But it is really important that we start to offer choice in the system, both to users and actually to judges and practitioners, that says the face-to-face hearing is not the only route that can ever be used in order to solve your dispute. And I would turn this thing on its head, actually. I don't think it's about saying we are trying to kind of do away with the online with the face-to-face hearing. It's about saying, do we seriously believe that there are disputes where the best way of resolving them is always a face-to-face hearing, and that online cannot be better? I have an analogy which I sometimes use, which is a bit risky, and I'd just like to say before I use the analogy that I know it's not perfect. But it goes like this. 10, 15, 20 years ago, there were an awful lot more banks on the high street, and over time we've seen a lot of disputes about the closure of the high street bank, and many people would say that the best kind of banking is the kind of banking where you have a nice bank on the high street and a nice bank manager who you know and who you can go and talk to about your banking. And that is top banking, and that's the best banking. And other kinds of banking are second-rate banking. And I occasionally offer people this trade. It goes like this. It's okay, I'll bring it back. I will give you a bank on every high street and a lovely bank manager in every bank. I'll do it tomorrow. All you have to do is to sign up to one tiny condition. The tiny condition is this: I will give you that, but could you please give me online banking and ATM machines? Would that be okay? Because the bank manager is the best banking, and you can have that back. Would that be good? We have that? We need the bank manager when we want a mortgage. We definitely do. We need to go and talk to him when we have something serious to discuss. But for quite a lot of banking, he is not the best banking. The best banking is the one that lets us do something quickly and conveniently that fits in with our lives. Now, I understand the imperfections of this analogy. I'm sure they will be pointed out to me shortly. But but my question is just, unless we think that absolutely every case needs a face-to-face hearing, this is the right thing for us to do to provide more and different routes that work properly, and that is what we're aiming to do. Thank you very much.
I'd like to ask Sir Ernest Ryder to speak next. He's Lord Justice of Appeal, but more importantly, he's the Senior President of Tribunals for the UK. And he's working cooperatively with the senior presiding judge, Adrian Fulford, to design and implement reform of courts and tribunals. Ernest.
Thank you, Hazel. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to try and deal with a vast amount of information with a series of sound bites, for which no apologies. It's taken the judiciary a long time to understand what a sound bite is. So now that we've got there, we might as well use the skill. Let me start off with online processes within tribunals, and I add into that civil and family courts, because the principles will be no different. They are all going to be about improving access to justice. They'll start to become visible by September 2017, and we will be working in more than one tribunal by January 2019. We hope to have reached all tribunals by May 2020. And by then, you'll have gone beyond civil money claims in the civil courts and gone beyond probate and divorce into private and public law family proceedings in the family courts. There'll be no big bang. There will be, as Richard entreats us, a gradual learning curve. Some things will not work, and we should expect that. And there will not be one size that fits all. The number of times I've had to answer questions from the most intelligent commentators about what end-to-end online digital tribunals means rather betrays the fact that people still believe in concrete, literal language which frankly is probably at the level of the young contributor on the fourth row. What is needed for a party state jurisdiction like benefits appeals will not be the same as that which is needed for party-party jurisdictions like public law, family, employment, or property. But each will use some of the same components, in particular IT components. For example, a digital system or portal to make your application. It may look different to each user and in each jurisdiction, but it's based on the same principles. A system to upload your documents onto the cloud. A system that permits digital case management by judges and parties alike. Virtual hearing systems, whether they're Skype, video, telephone, or otherwise. And in my case, and this is what Richard was alluding to earlier on, a form of online continuous hearing that is an inquisitorial investigation of jurisdictional fact in plain language by the panel members of the benefits claimant. There are many more examples of those components. There are more than 100 of them, but they come together in different ways, different combinations, for each jurisdictional service that we seek to offer. We decided to start with Social Security and Child Support Tribunal. The Chamber President of Social Entitlement, John Aitken, is here, and I'm sure he would be happy to talk to anybody about what he's doing. It is really quite innovative stuff. We move on through immigration and asylum for fairly obvious reasons. If you're an out-of-country appeal, you want a virtual hearing rather than no face-to-face at all. You want to have the interpreter available to you when that person isn't available to you in the country where you're forced to reside and you do not want to be. It's an improvement in the service over what is presently on offer. And then we'll move through jurisdictions like employment, where already the majority of documentation is on the cloud, before dealing with some of the other discrete specialisms like war pensions, where, I don't joke, we're dealing with handwritten medical records from the Second World War still for some of our veterans. And if you're a veteran with Gulf War syndrome and you cannot use electronic processes, whether rightly or wrongly, the psychological component of your condition is such you will not touch the telephone, the tablet, or anything else. It's going to be on paper. So let's be absolutely real about this. We have to provide for the users of our systems. Some of the benefits I'm talking about will become visible to all tribunals as we go along, because once something works, there is absolutely no reason to introduce it across the board. But again, as Richard said, in an incremental way. And you can have one bit without the rest. It's part and parcel of the learning curve without the danger of a big bang. Everything is being tested with users, including judges, and then piloted before being introduced. Everything is advised upon by a series of advisory groups. We have judicial engagement groups and judicial boards that are at my end of the system, but also the litigant in person groups. There are more than 23 interest groups for litigants in person and those who are vulnerable, in need of assistance, and so on, and the professional engagement groups that Susan has been referring to. We will develop a new common or core process. That is a new procedure for all civil, family, and tribunals jurisdictions. So for those using the online system, the white book will never be appropriate. The red book will never be appropriate. It will be new plain language procedures with a new rules committee, which will be brought in when the Prison and Courts Bill finishes its passage through Parliament. We will not try and digitise existing procedures except in crime, and that's important. The Crown Court and contested summary process in the Magistrates Court have a procedure which politically I don't think anybody either wants to get involved in serious change, or perhaps arguably doesn't need the same change. It needs different things, but that is digitising an existing process. We'll provide a wholly new service for applicants and litigants in person. I have more than most, the majority of my applicants are litigants in person. They're majority vulnerable, some are incapacitated, some have mental health difficulties, a number, and we are concerned with the empirical foundation of what this number is, are unable to access or use themselves an IT service. So the assisted digital service is something that has to be very real. You have to be able to default to telephone, face-to-face assistance, or paper if you need to do so. And I'm acutely aware of that in relation to tribunals users. We will be using more of our existing, and we think, highly successful registrars and case officers to give standard directions, to triage cases, that is to allocate them, to send them off for alternative dispute resolution, to deal with queries that otherwise would require a short directions hearing, and to deal with case progression. The more qualified, that is the legally qualified registrars, may be able to undertake alternative dispute resolution themselves in the same way that you can in the county court at the moment, though that telephone service is completely overwhelmed by the volume of people who would like to use it. In the tribunals, we are well used to this service. Indeed, we don't understand the criticisms of it, because every one of those case officers and registrar by name has delegated authority only for what I personally delegate to them with my chamber presidents. They're reviewed by their own judges, they're monitored and supervised by those judges, and there's an automatic right of review, not appeal, automatic right of review of any case officer's decision. The benefit that they bring in terms of speed and effectiveness is phenomenal. And you put them inside a digital system and you have somebody able to monitor what the lay person may not realize is going wrong themselves, who can telephone and email and communicate, in essence, with the person to say, do you realize you're going out of time? Do you realize you haven't uploaded a document? Do you realize it's upside down, wrong way round, and I can't read it? Fairly basic things, but it's what goes wrong every single day of the week, including in the Court of Appeal. Over time, we will remove paper and provide a wholly new customer service for all civil family tribunals jurisdictions together. And they'll come together in the same buildings, either in regional hubs or national centres. There may be some big tribunal centres where there are two or three or four tribunals that come together. It is likely that there'll be single criminal centres because Crown Courts and magistrates will become closer and closer together, both in terms of leadership and their co-location, and they are highly likely to remain separate from my jurisdiction, civil and family. The question mark where detained asylum and immigration claimants should go, because sometimes the secure estate is still needed, and that's not always in a civil building. But we need to solve the problem of lengthy delay, unintelligible process and language, and restricted access to justice, not least because of cost. That has led to managed decline. I agree with the Lord Chief when he says we can no longer sustain managed decline. You get to the point of a precipice where there is no longer a status quo you can preserve. If decline accelerates, that becomes a wholly unacceptable justice system. We're on the very edge of that. Our judges are on the very edge of it, and our users tell us we've gone beyond that edge in some circumstances. Lastly, I want to just look at some other opportunities. We're going to integrate the tribunal's judiciary with the court's judiciary. It will improve flexibility of deployment, diversity of recruitment, and career progression. It might actually improve the sharing of skills and expertise. We want to safeguard specialist and innovative identity of tribunals, for example, by the use of panel members. The consultation from government came out rather different from that where it started, and I, for one, I'm very grateful, as I shall be in the judicial review firing line if I get it wrong when we come to look at panel composition in the future. My judges will be able to hear concurrent courts and tribunals applications. Siobhan McGrath in property has just done property disputes in the county court and in the property tribunal, and we will be able to do that on a regular basis because the new rules will permit us to do that. We'll be able to use local facilities in local authority buildings, benefits hearing centres and the like, so that we're actually taking justice to people from the regional hubs. So my aim is to safeguard the rule of law by improving access to justice. I won't be persuaded to do anything that has the potential to do less than that. My presidents have six guidelines. One system which has to be first class, not second class justice. One judiciary to aim for better quality than you presently provide. It has to be specialist, innovative, and valued. If you manage all six of those things, then you've achieved something better than the status quo.
Thank you very much. I'd like to invite Andrew Langdon, who's chairman of the bar, to give us the view from the other side of the bench.
So I'm the first of the two lawyers, and I think it would be disappointing probably for you if I simply agreed with everything to be said. Can I reassure you I'm not going to agree with everything? But I want to approach it in this way. I think we need to concentrate upon the direction of travel. So we have a £25,000 ceiling potentially for an online court, but I think most of us with any imagination see that this is the beginning of a process which is likely, if successful, to extend far beyond that, both in terms of sums and in terms of consequences. Two things need separating out, quite obviously, it seems to me. One is digitization of documents and process, and nothing should stand in the way of that. It's happened in the Crown Court. It's happened in pockets elsewhere within our system. It ought to happen everywhere, and I suggest it ought to be the first priority. And when it happens, there's scope for streamlining systems, for removing antiquated processes, for rewriting rules in a way which can be understood by all. And if that's done, and if it's done well, it can only enhance our delivery, our reputation at home and abroad. And nearly all of that is captured, it seems to me, in most of the ambition for the court reform programme. And it's captured in much of Lord Justice Briggs' online solution court proposals. But the other part of it is technology which is being used to design something ostensibly on the basis that justice of the same quality can be delivered without, let me just put it this way for the moment, the input of lawyers. And inevitably that sounds like protectionism. And I'm going to go on using the word lawyer, but I suppose I just mean expertise, those who have knowledge of the law and those who have the experience and practice of dealing with people, vulnerable people largely, but all sorts of different people, and those who can I put it in this short way, combine those two things to know a good point from a bad point. And it's a truism, isn't it, that no one likes lawyers until they need one. And I include in that those that are designing system with a design condition that it must be able to deliver without the use of lawyers. We had concerns about Lord Justice Briggs' interim report, which expressly used the phrase lawyerless courts. In his final report, he spoke of the need to have lawyer input in terms of advice as to the merits, because we don't want the system to be clogged up with unmeritorious claims, and also in relation to complex final hearings or hearings where the credibility of witnesses needed to be tested. There was a role there for lawyers, and all of that, I hope, makes good sense to all of you. If you don't make provision for the use of lawyers and the cost recoverability for the successful party in relation to expenditure on lawyers, you move into a world where we have experience of this with litigants in person, You have people behind the scenes, paid Mackenzie friends and others, unqualified, unregulated, uninsured advisors in the background. Less visible is a concern in relation to online court. Equality of arms is a concern. If you can't see it in quite the same way, you can't sense in quite the same way what is going on in terms of who has the resources on either side of the case. And in relation to certain aspects, although we understand and applaud the desire to start with simple and small things, like those impressive slides we were shown, but the danger of dumbing down legal concepts, which have become refined over time in order to make them more navigable. There's a wider concern about the direction of travel away from hearings in a courtroom. And of course, those concerns are echoed across the transformation programme. And as with all change, there's much reassurance that particular cases or particular types of case will not, at least initially, be suitable for final resolution, save in a courtroom where, as much as is possible, everyone is physically present. And Lord Justice Briggs, in his report, refers to this as the face-to-face oral process, to distinguish it from telephone hearings or video hearings or resolutions online. Face-to-face oral process sounds more like the dentist than a hearing in court, I suppose. But arguments to do away with, or putting it another way, the reason we can relax about moving away from face-to-face oral processes, costs. Courts are expensive to run, and we need to save money. Secondly, convenience. It's easier to do it from home or from a nearby booth than actually to go to court. Technology is improving all the time, so good that it's actually like being there. You are virtually, if never actually, there. And fourthly, we're heading that way culturally. Handheld devices, FaceTime, less and less of a cultural shock to do the same thing in court. Those are the arguments, I hope I'm fairly summarising some of them, for moving in that direction. A reaction to that, it's, I confess, partly instinctive, but I hope it's also rational. And I noted very carefully the words that, Richard, you used. Emotional, intuitive, psychological, all those things. That tradition of dispensing justice face-to-face in the place where people have traditionally gathered, which has existed in pretty much every society from time immemorial, is that something we should throw over too lightly at the start of the 21st century without a great deal more thought and some very thorough testing of it first? Not to see if the technology works, because I'm sure, despite, frankly, our day-to-day experience, but I'm sure it can be made to. Okay, let's take that as read. It will be made to. It's not to test whether the technology works. It's to test how human society reacts on a more profound level to a shift away from the traditional process of dispensing justice. And if I call it a traditional process, it'll sound as if I've set my face against modernization. I prefer to call it the human process. So look, FaceTime, Skype, relatively recent inventions, we all use them, some of us do so routinely. Emails have been around en masse for however long, 25, 30 years. Telephone's been around for a very long time. The postal service even longer. But just ask yourselves, whatever you use, if you have something important to tell someone, hasn't it always been, and doesn't it remain better to do it face to face? If it's bad news, it may be more appropriate and more humane that you've taken the trouble to go. If it's good news, you can share in the pleasure in being there. If it's difficult or complicated, you might find yourself saying, even on, as it were, visual FaceTime, look, we need to meet up. I need to explain this to you. If you really want to understand someone, however good the technology, don't you want to meet them? You know, Spock, for those of you old enough to remember Star Trek, may raise an eyebrow at the illogicality of the suggestion that being in the same room matters. But Spock was not, strictly speaking, human. So I call the face-to-face process the human process. And cost and convenience, of course, are the drivers for change. But we have a choice. As a society, we can say yes, it'll cost less. It'll undoubtedly be more convenient. Some of it will be so much quicker. But some things, for human reasons, need to be done face-to-face. So, look, coming back to the specific online solution cord, it's going to work, I'm sure, in relation to relatively simple decisions that have to be made. If it's confined to those cases where there are, as it were, a relatively small number of options, and it may be that the majority of certain types of money claims, where there isn't any sort of argument about who said what, or who did what, or the impression that was given. But you start to think about that as a lawyer. You know, very often you meet a layman who will say, I haven't got any evidence. I haven't got any evidence. And you hold on a minute, let's just talk about it. What actually happened? How did he put that? And then you start to get the feel of it, and it turns out there is a little bit of evidence, but not quite what the layman had understood to be evidence. So that interaction between lawyer and client to bring out, you know, to meet the client. When you meet the client, the foremost factual assertion in the mind of the client or the claimant or the defendant is, in fact, often not the relevant thing at all. Buried somewhere behind it in that sense of injustice is a real factual thing or defense or whatever it may be. And that human reaction face to face with the lawyer is what brings it out. You try to encapsulate it and you try to put the best foot forward on behalf of the client. And it's that sort of human interaction which I am a little bit nervous we are, at a critical time, not thinking sufficiently about capturing. So, yes, good that we're going to have reassurance that it's going to be confined to this type of case where that sort of problem won't arise. But let's be very conscious as we develop this and as we travel this road together of the direction of travel overall. Think about the human relationship. Yes, I will wrap up. I was just going to sort of end in this way. The risk is that in our enthusiasm for what is possible to deliver by way of access to justice to as many people as possible, we take a step which means that we may look back and wonder if we took the right turn at the right moment. And I applaud the call and the need for research in this field. Thank you very much.
Finally, I want to ask Robert Bourns, who's the president of the Law Society, to give us a view from the Law Society.
Well, my own view, I think. Hazel, thank you very much indeed. Now, I'll stay sitting down, one, because I don't want to take the time running over there, and two, because you can jab me in the ribs and I've gone on for far too long. So, and I think actually we're in danger of recognising the balance in the argument that's been expressed. So far as I'm concerned, I welcome change. I've lived with change, as the rest of us have. I walked here past the Institute of Making, and I wonder what would be going on in a lecture theatre there, talking about the use of technology in the manufacture and processing. So it's the same in every element of society. We're grappling with, we're embracing, we're trying to make the best of it. And certainly we recognise and are grateful that there is now a significant level of investment in the system. I do wonder, and I've heard had the benefit, Richard's very kindly spent some time trying to persuade my partners to see the light in relation to process innovation in practice. And when he puts up that picture of the hole, I wonder, do I really want the hole, or what do I want to put in that hole, or hang off it? And in the context of this debate, I'd say we're hanging justice off that, and it's access to justice people have spoken about. As a profession, we are working very hard, and you've heard a number of occasions to the engagement groups referred to. We are pleased to engage with that. That is referred to as the society, actually that engagement is through the volunteer time of practitioners, solicitors and others who become engaged in those engagement groups, looking at procedures. How can we make it better? And we work with Susan in relation to HMCTS, and I know there's been input from practitioners who have looked at what's being developed and said, for example, in relation to a divorce petition, we are obliged or encouraged to serve it on the other side in draft, and actually wanted a provision on the system so that we could stop midway through the drafting process. That's taken on board. So we're working together so far as that is concerned. We work also in relation to the Jackson Review on fixed recoverable costs, and so on and so forth. There are concerns, and they've been voiced, and I'm not sure I'm going to follow the six classifications that Richard mentioned, but there is impact on individuals. And just because you are digitally literate, it doesn't mean that you are legally literate. And that, I think, is an important point that needs to be borne in mind. There are other characteristics, and we've heard reference to it, and how online actually can facilitate, but issues over language, issues over being a vulnerable user of the system. How is that reflected? Either because you're in custody, in hospital, in hostel, you're otherwise engaged in that situation. We was referred by Richard to escalation of litigation if, in fact, the implication was, and I think it was actually said, if lawyers are involved. How often do we hear with the increased number of litigants in person that actually cases have escalated beyond the point where if there had been advice in a timely fashion, it would have been resolved earlier. So I think those things are concerns that are recognised and we're concerned how those are dealt with. Independence of process. So the online court is being developed and it's being said that, and Richard again said, it's a state-provided system. And there are certain levels or classes of penalty offence that are going to be put into an online environment. You can volunteer for a sanction and, of course, to acquire a record. How do you know at that point in time, as a vulnerable individual, ushered into this online, easily facilitated system, that actually you are making the right decision? And there's been research where even where there was a duty solicitor available in the police station, over 50% of those in the police station in custody felt they were able to deal with the matter themselves without any advice. And that, I think, is something we need to be careful about. So justice as an executive function is something that I think we need to keep a weather eye on, which is different from the state providing the infrastructure, the physical infrastructure. When it moves beyond that in terms of selecting those matters that you can deal with without reference to advice, then it seems to me you're moving into a slightly different environment and we need to be careful about that. And of course, and I endorse what Andrew said about justice being done and being seen to be done, and there are elements to that. So what we say about this is that it's important, and I don't think there's disagreement on any element of this panel, it's not a criticism anybody, but there is an overarching access to justice strategy. And one of the things we did a lot of work of with others, and Nick's here from the Legal Trust, sorry, I beg your pardon, Nick, I'm trying to bring you into the conversation. But in last year, in relation to pro bono activity, talking to legal advice centres, Citizen Advice Bureau, and so on and so forth, the crying need is for public legal education as part of an access to justice strategy. So people understand both their rights, their responsibilities, their sanctions. So what are you going into this process to achieve in terms, so far as that's concerned? We saw that, as I say, last year. We see it in relation to the strategy that's proposed by the Civil Justice Council. We saw it again in the CMA review, Competition and Markets review, published just before Christmas. It talks time and time again. It's been translated into shorthand of transparency on price. Actually, it's about understanding of the system, understanding rights and responsibilities. So public legal education needs to be brought into this. And it does go a bit towards testing, and I don't have the empirical evidence. What is the extent of that unmet need, people who need to get into this system to resolve a dispute? What is the extent of the latent litigant? And is it really a situation where, at the moment, where so many of those who already have access to justice choose to resolve short of going to court, why are we ignoring that opportunity to resolve matters short of entering that process? So what we would say is that there is an order to the reform and commend all the investment, but there is presently a gap, and it would be wrong to speak here tonight without recognising that. Court closures. that are actually impacting adversely on access at the moment. Issue fees that have been increased hugely, 600%. No market can absorb that sort of shock and continue to function. Cost regimes. We've just had a closure of the consultation in relation to personal injury claims and small claims. Raise the threshold from £1,000 to £5,000. People cannot easily recover their costs. What is doing that doing to the access to justice? You can invest in the system, you can digitise it, but if you're loading the cost onto the system, then you are frustrating your aspiration and your objective and denying access to justice. And I'd also say this, and this is not about vested interest, there is value to independent advice. As I say, Richard's spoken about an app in Uganda being used by 45,000 practitioners. What I say is all this technological change actually also facilitates the practitioner, and we shouldn't ignore that. And that the practitioner, by adopting and embracing these changes, actually can make themselves more available to those who need advice. I went to see somebody over in Essex, a new practice he set up 3.5 years ago, who's got an international footprint in internet law. But it's all done by using generic, carefully chosen, but generic systems. And actually the cost of entry into practice falls as a consequence of that, and therefore there is still a very important role of making sure that people have access to independent advice in relation to their rights and so on and so forth, an adjunct to public legal education. So, and also in this environment, I just say professional standards have a value. You saw the online form, you saw somebody ticking a box, I agree. Now, our system, with the essence of professional standards, if I sign that saying I agree on behalf of my client and I actually breach that, then I am disappointing people by reference to professional standards. I can quite properly be disciplined for that. If somebody who is unrepresented, or some of the people that Andrew referred to as being ushered into, promoted into the system, were to sign that box, what is the consequence? What is the consequence? And what is the consequence on the integrity of the justice system if those who are using it can no longer rely upon other practitioners to subscribe to and be held to account against certain standards of behaviour? So I'd say we embrace change, we are supporting it, we're working with it, we share the concerns with some emphasis in some places. But thank you very much indeed.
Thank you.
Mandy Gibbs from Transform Justice. We haven't talked much about criminal online courts, and I wanted to know whether the panel had any concerns about how to make those open without damaging the process of rehabilitation by naming and shaming through publishing online convictions.
Who wants to take that? Ernest.
There is a large project which is more in the senior presiding judge's domain than mine, which is looking at data protection, the Rehabilitation of Offenders Act, misuses of data that exist at the moment on paper and in the public domain, let alone online, and also is aware of private hearings, less obvious in crime, but most certainly an issue right the way across the justice sector. You will be aware, I know, that we already publish lists so they can be manually and digitally searched. We already publish sentences and names where appropriate so they can be digitally searched. We already publish determinations, judgments, and the like, and we should do in an open justice environment. And the consideration for the future is going to be that where there is no obligation to provide privacy, some of my tribunals have to be in private, some of family has to be in private, but where it should be open, that there will be the equivalent of viewing rooms where people can watch if they're not physically able to go into the justice environment because it is online, or they can watch it happening in front of them. They can track the words that are being used or the sounds that are being used. None of that will be recordable to be used on YouTube. That will be a primary requirement of it, and the confidentiality and or the privacy implications of that, all I can do is assure you, is being looked at very seriously, including taking, I'm sure Andrew will be pleased to know, legal leading counsel's opinion on what is permissible and what isn't permissible for the future.
Thank you.
Yes, it is a serious question.
Thanks. Question there.
David Blyman, I'm a lay tribunal member and a member of the editorial board of the Tribunals Journal. The Tribunals Journal, which when you, Professor Genn, were editor, was a hard copy, but is now online only. And I just mentioned that because I want to get a quick plug in, because the last issue in autumn of 2016, which is available online, has an article by John Aitken about the developments which Sir Ernest referred to in the Social Security and Child Support Tribunal, so it may be of interest to people. But my question really is about judicial or judgecraft skills. I think that perhaps some of the unease which judges and tribunal members may feel about going online would be around thinking about, do you actually have the skills, or can you apply your judicial skills, the sort of skills about facilitating participation of litigants in person in a court, and things like assessing the credibility and reliability of witnesses. It's difficult to envisage how one would be using those skills in an online court. So it'd be very interesting to hear some thoughts on that.
Thank you.
I am very pleased, actually, that the Tribunal's Journal Board is running the series of articles that you are, because they will answer some of the questions that you've just posed over the next year. What we've put in place, and we've just delivered it, is, first of all, leadership training for all 250 senior and middle-level leadership judges across all courts and tribunals to actually then go out into the field and deliver training on the online and reform environment. The next step is to change the business of judging courses and the social context of judging courses, there are two, so that we enhance the unconscious bias training at the inquisitorial techniques that are needed in family and in tribunals, so that we are teaching that to a much broader range of judges. And one of the purposes of integrating the judiciary is the skills that my judges use on a day-to-day basis. And I suspect that Malcolm from the Magistrates Association would agree magistrates use on a day-to-day basis, get extended across the board. You don't have to wait to get to the Court of Appeal to be able to ask a question.
Thank you. I've got one there, and I've got someone there up the back, please.
Dr. Katrina Denver, Director of the Legal Innovation Centre at Ulster University. I'd like to direct the question to Richard, and it's in relation to whether you think the success of a system that widens access to justice could ultimately be its downfall. Because if you were to unleash a system like Susan demonstrated before on the general public, what you're going to get is a whole lot of nonsense in those forms, which only exacerbate the litigant in-person issue that we have in the courtroom, and exacerbates it. Because in a courtroom, a judge can ask directed questions, but in an online form system, they cannot do that. And so I wonder if you could speak to that, because a lot of the claims that come out about this notion of technology is that it's efficient and that it saves money, and I actually think that there are concerns that it could do the opposite.
Thank you. Richard and Susan, maybe answer.
There clearly is an issue, and there's always been a discussion about the extent to which making access to justice easier is going to make it a field day for vexatious litigants. Whether or not there is a whole body of vexatious litigants waiting in the wing because the online service is available, I'm not sure. I actually always argue rather the reverse. It seems to me that one of the exciting things about making it easier for people to understand and enforce their entitlements is that people who have for long managed to get away with all sorts of unacceptable behavior in the knowledge that another party wouldn't be able to raise an action against them, I think that kind of behavior may change. So for example, I pick a class as a grossly sweeping statement, but if one accepts there are some landlords who take advantage of tenants who are ill-informed about the law, if it becomes easier for tenants to understand the law and enforce their entitlements, my premise would be that that will actually change behavior. So I take a bigger view of the likely social impact of having accessible legal resolution at your fingertips. Your point about the actual use of the system, this goes back to much that Susan has been saying, is that we are going to learn over time. I'm sure at the outset, and Susan expressly said this, there will be difficulties, there'll be dead ends, but we have to accept as we transition that this will be the case. But the design of the programme is such that one would hope, and I think with confidence, if one looks at online services in medicine, if you look at online services in tax, 48% of United States people in 2014 completed pretty difficult online taxation forms themselves. If one looks at evidence of systems that reformed over and been refined over a period of 2 or 3 years, I think we can distill out the difficulties. I'm not minimizing the problem to which you draw our attention, but I want you to think of the bigger picture, because I think it could change societal behaviors, and that if the system, and I hate to use the term agile, but it is agile development, it's developed specifically so that these forms become more intelligible, easier to use, and flush out the difficulties that you're referring to.
Susan. So just a couple of things, I'll try not to speak long. I think you're quite right. When you make things accessible to people, it becomes possible for people to shove lots of stuff through them, and some of that may be things that need us to think about how we manage them. But I mean, you need to remember that at the moment it's open to people to fill in forms and send them to the court service, and an awful lot of what we get needs a bit of help one way or another. And generally speaking, I think online systems will allow us to guide that process better and get better quality submissions and input into the system. So as I said about the Help with Fees service, we've massively improved the extent to which people are able to fill in that form and get the right outcome. And as it so happens, we have also saved ourselves an enormous amount of processing time dealing with forms that were filled in wrong. And that's money we save not by offering a worse service, but by offering a better one. And that's the aim. I think the other thing that's worth saying is that, and I should have made this really clear, that process I put up on the screen is not a process in which there is an algorithmic resolution to the problem that doesn't involve people. So it links to what Ernest was saying about the use of both case officers and judges. So that is information where there's, as it moves into the hearing phase, there will be people who are interacting with each other who can say, this bit looks a bit odd, did you really mean that? But also people who can say, it doesn't look like this claim as you've set it out is quite one that's gonna, you know, get very far. Do you want to get some advice perhaps and think about that again? I also think it's really important to say again, it is not a system that has been designed to remove helpful legal advice from people. It is a system that accommodates people having lawyers, which accommodates lawyers using the system on people's behalf. My preoccupation is that people should be using lawyers for legal advice, not for process navigation. I think it's important that the process can be navigated and that the lawyer is able to spend their time giving advice on the law.
Thanks. Robert, did you just...
I just wanted to say, picking up on Richard's point about an accessible system will be a force for good in terms of altering behaviours. I don't want to bang on about it, but the feedback I'm getting from practitioners in relation to the consequence of these enormous increases in issue fees is that where people now properly regard the risk of a claim falling against them as much reduced, they are finding it much more difficult. And we got this again through legal advice centres, but also those who'd act for claimant employees, they find it much more difficult to get those who have a responsibility, either as an employer or a statutory body, in fact, some of the executive functions, to pay attention to the claim, because they know that the individual, the vulnerable individual, the impecunious individual, is not likely to pay or be able to afford the very large issue fees. So again, that aspiration for access is being frustrated. So that's why we say a coordinated strategy is appropriate.
I'm just going to take one or two. I've just got one question up there and one person who's been waiting down there, and then I think I may call it a day. I'm sorry.
Go ahead. I'm speaking on behalf of my friend Josh Hebel here, who's doing an LLM in legal practice. He's looking at the persuasive nature of the voice in court and ultimately whether he would be able to deliver advocacy. He would like to know whether emotional aspects of the voice are necessary for a good advocate, or whether going online will help to remove the subjectivity and emotions that the voice and human nature bring about in the courtroom environment.
It's a gift question.
That's a bit of a gift. I mean, in a sense, I think that's a very profound question, and ultimately It's really what is justice about? Is justice in part something which is emotional? Is a good judge a judge who is emotionally sensitive, who can, as it were, do the whole human thing? Or is that interference and you're just looking for an accurate, logical outcome? And there's a whole spectrum in between. So my own personal view about that, perhaps inevitably, is that advocacy, and when adversarial advocacy works, it works very well, is an essential part of the outcome.
I think there are some very big issues in that.
Can I add that your colleague will be no doubt very well aware of the emotional or empathetic component of justice as described in the writings of Professor Sen. The answer to that question is that you cannot run a justice system which purports to be the glue in society without understanding the empathetic element, whether you're online or offline. And understanding somebody's credibility, reliability, the rationality, or the emotional elements of their claim have to be provided for. Online does not exclude that. One of the things it can do is to protect from the unconscious biases that we have to spend a lot of time, and rightly spend a lot of time, training judges about.
This is quite a challenge, I would say. There's one question down here. Thank you. It's a huge challenge.
Agreed. Good question.
I have the answer to most, if not all, of the questions you've posed. And some of the problems that you're facing, which is to have a very simple, early, neutral evaluation service at a fixed fee for people who don't understand the system, whereby they can come in with their six bags of papers, they can speak to people at law clinics and advice bureaus, the people in there who do a fantastic job, but a lot of cases have nowhere to go, then send them off to the law site or to the bar, and they will pick out, like they do with interventions, but a much lower level, the small cases, for a fixed fee, they get something back, which is an opinion on the merits, and says, you're wasting your time, or you've got trouble here. I had 20 years in car repairs before I did my law degree. I do it all the time. People come to me. I act as a mediation advocate, as a McKenzie friend, because people do not know how to understand, are they in trouble or they're not? Can they get justice or not? And you need something small. You're right to go even down to £5,000. Most of the people that need this information is at the very lowest level. And you will avoid them going to court if they just have something that says, this is the situation. They go, okay, their shoulders drop. They go, thanks very much, and they can move on.
Okay,
that's what you need.
That's an interesting solution. I think with that, we'll call it a day. I want to thank Richard Susskind for laying out the vision and the justification for it, and to our very distinguished panel for fascinating contributions. If we'd had three times the time, we would still be asking questions at the end. I think this is a subject that needs quite a lot of discussion and a lot of thinking through, wherever you stand in the debate. But anyway, could you join me, please, in thanking our speakers?